In the Great Hall of the Justice League, there are assembled the world's greatest heroes, created from the cosmic legends of the universe. Their mission, to fight injustice, to right that which is wrong, and to serve all mankind.
Shall we play a game?
Why, yes. I believe we shall.
Oh, I got a live one here.
Live from Little Rock and back on our home station of 96.5 FM, The Answer, it's Shane Plays Geek Talk. I'm your host, Shane Plays, or Shane Stacks, your host of Shane Plays. Feels so good to be back. I really appreciate Salem Communications here in Little Rock working with me during the Wichita Baptist football schedule to make sure I can still go out live on 99.5 Faith Talk. But there's no place like home. There's no place like home, so I clipped my ruby slippers together, and here we are. So, and we're definitely not in Kansas. We're in Arkansas, not Arkansas. Mike is Michael Brown, friend of the show, comedian and professional geek and TV and movie critic.
As dubbed by local media.
Yeah, are we allowed to say the CW?
Sure.
It was the CW and
Fox 16.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're partners. I didn't realize. Are they content partners?
Yeah.
I didn't realize that. Well, that's super cool, man. So we are going to be talking today. If the little audio clip right before the show intro wasn't of Justice League.
Oh, man.
We're going to be talking today Justice League, the movie, and the state of the DCEU. For some reason, Marvel has a cinematic universe, but DC has an extended universe. I don't know why. So,
well, I have theories.
Do you? Okay. Well, we'll talk about that. Zach, engineer extraordinaire, finally got you back, man. So I appreciate Steve Marston helping me out, but Zach's my man. It's good to have you back.
Nice to have you here.
It's
too.
like not having Zach is like flying the Millennium Falcon without Chewbacca. It's just not right. Right? It's not.
Yeah.
I mean, and you're prettier and you smell better than Chewbacca. I just want you to know that. And you're more articulate. You can articulate. But folks, if you don't forget, if I don't banter with Zach at least once an episode, then Sal, who's the head of the news team, his grandmother and her dog Muffin get upset at me. So I've been getting nasty grams for like almost 2 months now.
Oh, my.
So, Zach, please banter with me. Did you enjoy your Thanksgiving?
Yes, I did.
Now, if I remember last year, you're not a turkey guy. You ate like macaroni and cheese or something.
Mm-hmm.
Did that happen again this year?
Yes, it did.
You make me sad, brother.
That's all I can eat.
You make me sad.
Did you do the green bean casserole, or are you just a mac and cheese?
Mac and cheese.
Mac and
strictly mac and cheese.
Yeah, some ham.
Okay. Oh, okay. Hey. Well, there we go. Okay. All right. How about you, Michael Brown?
I got to spend my Thanksgiving with my in-laws this year. It was there. We take turns.
Sure. Yeah. As many families do.
Yeah, like you do. And so this year was my wife's family and I love spending Thanksgiving with them because they don't cook. We go out to eat.
Oh, okay. Some families do that. It's
and
different.
And the restaurant we went to is a very great, very good restaurant, and they had a Thanksgiving buffet, and it had everything that you could want there, and I had my turkey, and I had my gravy, and I had my stuffing, and I had all the things that you have.
Beautiful. Yeah, we had a good Thanksgiving. We went to, unfortunately, my wife's brother is extremely sick, so we still had a nice day. I mean, very nice day, but... We spent Thanksgiving there as opposed to somewhere else we probably would have because we wanted to be there. So, and it was a good time. I mean, it was so, Roger, if you're listening, we love you. So he's not much of a geek, so I doubt he's listening, but you never know. So Roger, we love you. If you're listening,
I have to go back and backtrack. My in-laws do cook.
Yeah.
They just don't cook on Thanksgiving.
Well, fair enough. Yeah.
That was the best part about it. Because after we were done, we didn't have to clean up
anything. Well, yeah, because there's usually one or two poor souls who get stuck, like, there for 3 days. Everybody else shows up, and they're like, thanks, and it's over, right?
So, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, anyway.
No cleanup.
Moving on.
I you know, I've had Christmases and Thanksgiving when we went out to eat before.
Sure.
And it's nice. So it is. Yeah, everybody's different. Yeah, there's
nobody's wrong here.
No judgment here.
Okay,
so,
good.
Okay, cool.
Good.
All right. And because either way, you're going to gobble it up, right?
Right.
So, okay, folks, this is Shane Plays Geek Talk. It is live Geek Talk Radio.
Well, it's not food talk?
It's not food talk.
Okay.
But everybody becomes a food geek on Thanksgiving.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah. So the call-in number is 501-823-0965. That's 501-823-0965. And you could also tweet me at Shane Plays, SHANEPLAYS. So we actually have a couple of tweets already.
Oh, right.
That we'll get to on the air, Mike.
Cool.
Had some people already tweet just from the announcement that the show is today. But if you're out there listening, feel free to call in 501-823-0965 or tweet me at Shane Plays. Show notes and links for this show will be up for the podcast and Krypton radio version. Remember, we this show does go out as a podcast at the blog at shaneplays.com, iTunes, Google Play Music, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, SoundCloud, and more. And we also go out on Krypton Radio. Krypton Radio is sci-fi for your Wi-Fi, kryptonradio.com. And that we're currently replayed a week delayed on Krypton Radio on Saturdays and Mondays. But Gene Turnbull over there has a super secret mad scientist plan. I think we're going to start being live on Krypton Radio.
So on
potentially,
the day.
Potentially around the world via
wow,
the internet.
Wow, dude. That's
yeah.
cool, man.
Yeah, we could, yeah. We already stream via the radio website.
Right.
So at 96.5fmtheanswer.com.
Sure.
So potentially, and we've actually had live tweets from like Argentina and like the UK and
right
stuff,
on.
Which is cool.
Yeah.
But you know, anyway, so
a platform like Krypton Radio though is also super, very, very
well, it's
good.
24/7 geek internet radio.
Indeed.
Yeah. So it's cool stuff. So last week's show, we didn't have one. It was the first time in the history of Shane Plays, almost 2.5 years. I just didn't do a show because the football schedule got extended, right, and my guests needed to reschedule. I just came out of an extremely busy time at work, so I just took the week off. But
no judgment.
Fortunately from thanks, pal. Fortunately for me, but not good for Washaw Baptist football, they lost their playoff game, so I'm back on the air at my normal time. No, yeah, the football's over. We're not on any station change till next October and November when football season starts again.
Sure.
Okay, so having said all that, going to move us forward here. Shane Plays sponsor Collector's Edition, also known as the comic book store. Michael Tierney had the last day of their Thanksgiving sale is today.
Today.
Today. You can get 25% off back issues and graphic novels, and their 50-cent comics are a quarter. And he's got long box after long box after long box full of 50-cent comics. So go out there and load up. So
yeah,
there's some. I actually got the entire run of Elektra Assassin.
No kidding.
For a quarter of pop.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Yeah. So that was the last time he had a sale like this.
Ask
yeah.
for the Gecko. He's the only one that still has
the Gecko.
He's the only one that still has copies of my old comic from like 17 years ago.
Yeah, you and Patrick Nestor, which I'm sorry, he's gone now. Yeah, As I told you, I didn't know him directly, but I knew him through the comic and I liked him. So great. The Gecko was great. I loved it. I wish y'all would have, you know, been able to, for whatever reason, to keep going with that.
Me too. It was a good first start. We had really good reviews. But Michael Tierney is the only one that I know of that still has it to sell.
Nice.
So, yeah.
Nice. Okay, so moving right along, we're going to have one news item.
Okay.
And I'm going to make it super, super quick because today is Justice League. But, Zach, turn on the microphone, the secret microphone in the news team. There it goes.
Oh.
Sal's in there working hard with the news team. And his grandmother and her dog Muffin should be happy this week because I did banter with you can confirm I bantered
yes,
with Zach.
Okay. That is confirmed.
Yeah.
Independently.
And, yeah.
By a third party.
By a third party. That's right. An officially verified audit company. So folks, don't forget that for every dollar of support that the show gets by Patreon, the news team gets a penny an hour raise. It's a win-win for everybody.
Yeah,
it's a win-win
might be able to afford to get Sal off that typewriter.
Well, he's also been he prefers the typewriter.
Oh, does he?
Yeah, he's
okay.
It's an affectation, right?
I understand.
But he has been chomping on the same unlit cigar for like 2 years now. It's pretty soggy.
Is that what that was?
Yeah, it's bad. Oh. Okay, so according to comicbook.com and many, 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 many other news sources, including Marvel itself, Axel Alonso editor-in-chief of Marvel is gone.
Yep.
Gone.
Yep.
Ding dong. The witch is dead.
This is the guy that caused all the consternation.
Yeah. No, his days of saving comic books from old white guys that only do it as a hobby are over. I hope you hear this, Axel. I don't wish you ill in life, but I don't want you anywhere near Marvel Comics or DC. Go away. Go away. You have no idea. And I know you thought you were doing something great by doing diversity and this and that and that. I'm not against what you did. I'm against how you did it.
Right on.
Right?
Yeah.
And I'm against you oversaw Captain America being a Nazi. And don't give me a, well, it was really, you oversaw Captain America being a Nazi.
He approved it.
As being an editorial response to conservatism and Trump. Goodbye. Okay.
All right.
I'm getting out of my system.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. So
I'm so happy I don't buy comics anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
I really don't have a take on this other than do we know that it was clearly a firing for poor performance insofar as sales and the direction he was taking the company or the direction he was taking the stories?
Okay. Fair question.
Or was he sexually harassing someone?
Fair question. I think, reading between the lines, this is speculation, that...
And I say that only chuckling because I don't know the guy.
Yeah.
Not that that's a funny thing.
I have not heard anything about sexual harassment or anything like that.
Okay.
It happened very abruptly.
Mm.
There was no jiggles on the... on the news wire. It was
right,
coming.
Right.
No hints from him. No, happened very abruptly. So
it was very out of the blue.
It was very out of the blue to a lot of people.
There was no talk like he was a football coach about to get fired a week before.
No, it was
like he's on the bubble.
Usually when this happens, a few months down the road, he'll start making like press comments like, I'm thinking about, you know, but no, this is boom, gone.
Wow.
And Marvel has basically, for the most part, damned him with faint praise.
Okay.
They've said nice things, but it's kind of like, bye, Axel, thank you for what you did. And that's been it.
Okay.
So I think it's
thank you for teaching us what not to
do. Well, I mean, DC's been giving him a run for the money for the first time ever, at least in modern era of comics. You know, they've literally had closed-door meetings at Comic-Cons where the dealers are shouting and screaming at the editorial staff.
You and I actually talked about
this. It's bad. So but I don't want to spend... I'm glad he's gone.
Oh, fair enough.
I do not wish him ill in life. I'm sure he has a family, friends,
but he
loved
just doesn't need
want
to have
there.
Anything to do with
I don't want
comics
him there.
Anymore.
And my final thing on this, unless it comes back up again, there's nothing wrong with diversity in comics. There's nothing wrong with reflecting your culture in comics.
Right.
But create new characters or take existing characters that already reflect that and put the spotlight on them.
Yeah.
Don't co-opt existing characters for social conditioning, you know.
But, I agree.
Yeah, not only did it upset a lot of people that could tell what was going on, but their sales were tanking.
Really?
So yeah, no, and that's it. I want to, unless somebody else has something they want to say, I'm done on that. But ding dong, the witch is dead.
I got nothing. So
yeah,
I'm good with it.
Bye. Everyone's like, well, who's replacing him? I don't care. Not Axel. What's his name? Not Axel. That's all I want to see on the nameplate.
Right.
Anyway, okay.
Fair enough.
So today we are talking about the Justice League movie and the state of the extended DC universe. Okay, so that's the topic today.
Yeah.
Now, all three of us have seen Justice League.
Yes.
And I'm including Zach because Zach is basically a guest today, whether he likes it or not. So...
You're in the mix.
Yeah,
Zach.
You know, Zach, because Zach is a bona fide geek.
Fair enough.
He just doesn't have the years of soaking up certain geek things that you and I have.
No doubt.
But he's there. He's more current
than I am.
Yeah, he keeps up with the TV, the movies. Now, he won't read a non-digital comic book, but, I mean, that's just because... I don't know. There must have been some aerosol explosion that affected all the millennials out there.
Yeah.
So, you know, some sort of secret because it got into his DNA.
Okay.
Because I brought him a free comic book day of like Captain America one time or something. He kind of held it. He's like, What am I supposed to do with this?
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. Oh, yeah.
So, okay. Anyway, we've all seen Justice League. I've seen it twice. I saw it the night it opened. I didn't know I was going to get to do that. It right happened on very short notice. So, in a flash, yeah, we went and saw it.
Okay.
In 3D, not my preference, but still enjoyed it. And then I saw it again. We've been working our tails off at work, and I'm not even exaggerating. So we did sort of an extended lunch team outing and went and saw it again on Tuesday. So right I've seen it twice.
Matinee.
Yeah. Yeah. Nice. It's very nice. Very nice.
Cool.
Went to Tokyo House. Had a nice lunch. Yeah, you know. Yeah, and then the
nice
movie.
Nice at the Tokyo House.
Yeah, nice. You know, it's very good. It's very good.
Yeah.
So, Michael.
Sir.
Give me your thoughts on the Justice League movie.
Okay. The only thing that I've publicly said about it so far, and I've been holding back because of my appearance on this show. So if anybody wants my fresh take on this, they would have to tune in. But what I initially said was I saw it, I liked it. That's the distilled down to the bare elements in the Crucible review of it. However, did I have problems with it? Yeah. Did I have problems with the movie itself? Yeah. Was it for the acting? Not necessarily. Was it for the fact that there were two directors? Sort of. Maybe not in the way most people did.
For the people who don't know, first of all, this show, spoilers.
Okay.
Okay, good. I
didn't know.
There will be spoilers. No, spoilers.
Okay.
I'm sorry. We can't go into this without spoilers.
I was trying to word very carefully.
Yeah, if you have spoilers.
All right.
And the other thing is, just in case people don't know, Zack Snyder, who oversaw Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, and most of Justice League,
yeah,
had to step down, and it's very terrible. He had a family tragedy,
yeah,
but I think also it kind of aligned with. I really think Warner Brothers wanted to kind of start moving
pushing
him out of the way,
anyway,
but I don't know. And then Joss Whedon, who is a magnificent storyteller,
yes,
in my opinion, you know, Avengers, Buffy, Firefly, all that,
all of it,
stepped in. And supposedly was just going to, quote unquote, finish up, but obviously did assumptions or speculations up to 20% of reshoots on the movie. So,
I will say that, and we talked about this off the air before the show, that there were articles out there where they were trying to figure out or break down which parts were Zach and which parts were Josh.
There's some people who are very perceptive that can say they can literally see the stitches in between scenes.
Yeah. No doubt. Yeah. Basically, I knew which scenes were Joss Whedon's because those were the scenes I liked. That is how I knew.
Okay, well, there's one point I want to make sure to make today, and this is a perfect time to make it.
Okay.
And there are post-credit scenes. I was literally in the theater the second, I looked it up real quick on my phone. So I'm literally shouting out, there's post-credit scenes in the theater, right? Because everyone's used to DC not doing that.
Right.
Right. And the second movie, one guy still got, I was like, you fool, there's post-credit scenes.
Right.
But the first post-credit scene.
Yes.
We're in spoiler mode now.
Yes.
Flash Superman, the classic race.
Yes.
Right?
A version of the start of it. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, because Superman's flying and not running. But anyway, that post-credit scene condensed and summed up everything that's been missing from the DC movies.
Absolutely.
Gotcha.
100%.
Yep. That it nailed everything that's been missing.
And quite frankly, all the scenes that I've referred to that I thought were Joss Whedon scenes because I was like, oh, those are the scenes I liked.
Right.
Those scenes are what the DCEU
needs to be. Yeah.
And it needed to have.
Yeah.
And I feel empathy and I feel badly for the reasons why Zack Snyder had to bow out of helming the film.
Right.
I had heard that both the cinematographer and the editor both want to see the Zack Snyder extended version. I don't. If it means that I lose my Joss Whedon scenes. Because I'm done with Zack Snyder.
I'm done with Zack Snyder being the visionary, direct, creative person behind the DC universe.
Absolutely.
300 was amazing.
Yeah.
Watchmen
was great.
Was darn good.
Watchmen was fine.
Yeah. Well, it was.
It was fine. Yeah,
it was fine. But 300 spectacular.
Yeah. He peaked at Watchmen.
Yeah. Zack Snyder, in a certain element, is exceptional. His vision is of a dark DC universe is not what we want. Nobody wants it.
It doesn't quite work.
Yeah.
With this group.
Right.
It doesn't quite work with your flagship character.
He should have like the visionary control for like Suicide Squad.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
Yeah, Zach's pointing at me like, yep. Zach and the engineers. But yeah, Zack Snyder is joining us for the show today.
Oh, well, let me.
Yeah, he's over there chewing his lip.
Let me extend my apologies.
All right, let me do this. I gotta take us to a break. When we come back, I'll give my take and we'll dig more into it.
I barely have scratched the surface.
Yeah, it's so hard to. We'll try to get as much as we can in today. So, Zach, if you would go ahead and take us to a break. When we come back, we'll have more with comedian and official TV and movie critic Michael Brown as we talk about Justice League and the DC Extended Universe.
Comic book lovers, visit thewildstars.com today. From the mind of author and comic book industry expert Michael Tierney, it's not just a comic book, it's a comic book novel. The Wild Stars is sci-fi and so much more. Learn the explanations behind UFOs and space gods. This isn't the Twilight Zone. This is the region of the Milky Way galaxy known as the Wild Stars. We guarantee you've never read anything like it. The complete comic book novel took 20 years to tell. With one reviewer noting, the story of the Wild Stars stretches ambitiously across space and time. From small town murders to the destruction of planets, with every event given multiple layers of meaning. If you haven't read The Wild Stars, you're missing out. Visit thewildstars.com today.
The die is cast.
Plunge into worlds of fantastic adventure where dragons lie and the undead stalk the shades of your mind's imagines. Where creatures of legend plunder wealth through the horror of their passage. Monsters grim and foul hold the ecstasy of gold and the renown of glory. All this and more awaits you and your friends in the unlimited, fantastic world of the Castles and Crusades role-playing game from Trollord Games. Visit your friendly local game store or trollord.com to get your copy today. A rules-light, adaptable game that has stood the test of time. 12 years in constant publication with no new additions, Castles and Crusades is the original easy-to-play attribute check system. Join us and unleash your imagination. Visit your friendly local game store or trollord.com to get your copy of Castles and Crusades today. Shane Plays Radio is blessed to have sponsors and we appreciate them very much. However, did you know that you can also support the show as an individual for as little as $1 an episode? Simply go to patreon.com/ShanePlays.
And that, of course, was the theme music from Justice League Unlimited.
Yeah, because
not
of the,
Justice League, the original
correct.
Animated.
That the was electric Unlimited. Guitars are yeah. the dead giveaway between the two.
I like both series.
Me too.
I prefer Unlimited because of just all the extra characters you get.
It's more episodic,
yeah.
too.
Yeah, but the original Justice League Animated, I think they went 2 seasons and then they went yeah. to Unlimited, is excellent stuff.
Absolutely.
But the opening wears me out because it's so slow and that
don't yeah.
I much prefer the music of the opening of Justice League Unlimited.
They were trying to establish
yeah the icon.
This is some gravitas.
Yeah. And a lot of people love it. Cool.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
if I want to get pumped up, I want that the Unlimited theme.
Electric guitar yeah. riff. Yeah.
I am Shane Stacks, the host of Shane Plays Geek Talk. This is Michael Brown, friend of the show, professional comedian And TV and movie critic and card carrying geek and all that stuff.
Yeah, man.
And then, of course, we have Zach in the engineer's booth helping run the show, who's also a big geek. We're talking Justice League and the current state of the DCEU, which is their shared cinematic universe.
Yeah, I touched on that a little bit.
Yeah, I touched on that. And then, you know, before the break, we, you know, talked a little bit about what Michael thought of the movie. We talked about the stuff that Joss Whedon has been doing,
yeah,
is what it's been missing,
yeah,
especially that first post-credit scene.
See, this is what, yeah, I thought you and I would be agree on.
Yeah, on that stuff, yeah.
Yeah.
This, folks, spoiler warning, we're going, you know, we're going to touch on some stuff that has spoilers.
No doubt.
So, normally, I try to wait a couple of weeks till after a movie's been out, but this, we know it's only been out a week. So, anyway, if you want to call in and join the conversation, it's 501-823-0965. You can call in and join, or you can tweet me at Shane Plays. I've also got a Facebook post up. You can leave a comment there. Now, we've got a couple of Twitter comments.
Yeah, mentioned.
Yeah. So let's take a look here. Jay Renslow, he said, and this, he sent this to, I have two Twitter accounts. I have Shane Plays,
yeah,
which is more my chatty kind of personal. Then I have Shane Plays PR,
right,
which is, I want as many followers as possible. It's up to like 12,000, and I'm less chatty. But right, I get my announcements out and
talk about the show.
Yeah, and they both responded to that one. And Jay Renslow said, and he's Toxic Cyclone on Twitter, he said, maybe if they focused on the script and story anywhere close to how they focused on special effects, it could be worth seeing. Superman was bad. Bat versus Superman was so bad. And by Superman, he means Man of Steel.
Yeah.
Wonder Woman was mediocre. It just surpassed expectations. Why go see another one? That's, and I think, I think that, that feeling is kind of contributing to why domestically the movie's underperforming in box office expectations, because a lot of the fan expectation and desire,
yeah,
I think, got expended during Batman v Superman. There was all that.
I don't disagree with that.
Yeah.
I would also factor in perhaps,
yeah,
a little bit of superhero movie fatigue.
Yeah, you just had Thor a couple of weeks
you
ago.
You just had Thor. Yeah. You just, earlier this year, you've had Spider-Man.
Yeah.
You've had whatever the heck else. We, yeah, had
Logan.
Thank you. Logan. I knew there was another one.
Yeah, there's been a bunch.
Mm-hmm. And
you got Black Panther coming.
You got Black, right, Panther, and, yeah, coming after New Year's. And as far as geek movies go, yeah, we just had Thor Fraggle Rock. And then then on the heels of that, 2 weeks later, you have Justice League. And then we're going to, right around the corner, we got a new Star Wars.
Right. Yeah. It's yeah. I feel like.
Which I just bought tickets to today.
To the new Star Wars. I'm waiting.
Yeah.
I have a couple of buddies that may be coming in from out of town. So I'm
first
waiting.
Showing,
I'm waiting.
Night.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm Thursday night.
I did last.
Yeah, me too.
I did 2 years ago. I don't know if it's going to work out this year because I'm waiting on my buddies. Schedules. I'm not going to see it without them.
I'm
so,
not waiting.
Yeah,
I'm not
you're
waiting
in there.
On this one.
Well, I've been saying all year, Dave Ellswick and I on Shane Plays a year ago or at the beginning of the year counted down our top most anticipated geek movies of,
yeah,
the year, and Star Wars was my number one.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry. Star Wars.
No,
you know,
it's,
yeah, so,
you can't beat it.
All right. So we have one more comment here from Autumn Mirabilis, and he is Star Superion,
okay,
on Twitter. And folks, go follow his account because he's an excellent comic book artist. Why this guy hasn't been snatched up by Marvel or DC or IDW or Dark Horse or whoever.
All right.
He posts his stuff and it's really fantastic. So I've been following him for a while now. Anyway, so those are our Twitter comments.
What did he say?
Okay, sorry. He said, release the original Snyder version. There's a movement out there.
Okay, yes, there is.
And you had said before the break,
yeah,
that you really don't want it. So,
not full on Snyder. I can't imagine how much more dire. Dour,
yeah,
it would be. plus, they were talking about the head, the CEO of Warner Brothers, laid down the law that this movie was not to be over 2 hours.
Yeah, that's a bummer.
Makes no sense.
And
Thor was like 220.
It was pretty long. And then, and I understand the reasons why he wants it to be no less than 2 hours, because if it's only 2 hours, that's more showings per,
right,
day, more money,
right,
is how much it's going to make.
But let me just say that. If,
yeah,
you make a longer movie that's better, it'll have longer legs in the theater, and you'll make more money.
One would say.
One might think.
And there are anywhere between 45, I've heard different conflicting reports, 45 to 50 minutes of footage that were left on the floor.
Right.
From Zack Snyder's cut.
Wow.
Before Joss was able to cobble it together.
Mm.
Which is one of the reasons why they had to have the reshoots. It's one of the reasons why Superman's lip looks a little funny in a couple of scenes.
Yeah. Okay. But folks, if you don't know, and I don't think I knew this or I wasn't paying attention. I watched the movie and then I went and read up on it.
Yeah.
During the movie, there were a couple of times I'm like, he's smiling kind of weird, but that's all I thought about it.
Yeah.
And then evidently for the reshoots, Henry Cavill. Is that how you say his name? Cavill?
Henry Cavill.
Yeah. Cavill. He had a big, like...
He's got a big old
bushy Burt Reynolds, Tom Selleck mustache.
Yeah.
Which you couldn't shave because he was on another movie.
Yeah.
So
new Mission Impossible. He's the bad guy Impossible movie.
So they CGI'd his mustache out.
Yeah. Now, I'll say this about that. If for everybody who's complaining about Henry Cavill's lip looking weird, first of all, they're doing the best they could
Joss is like, I know this isn't, we got to do this.
And and for what it was, it wasn't that bad.
It didn't distract that much to me. I think that there's people who are, you know, like audiophiles.
Yeah.
Like they're super sensitive to musical stuff.
Yeah.
I think there's video movie files that are super sensitive to that kind of thing.
I agree. Yeah. Number two point on that is most of those same people were complaining that Superman wasn't smiling enough.
Oh, well, he can't.
In Man of Steel.
Right.
Or in BVS.
Right.
He was just not the cheerful Superman before he dies. They bring him back to life.
And it's itchy.
And he's super happy about it now. Yeah. You can't stop Superman from smiling.
Right.
Superman's smiley in this whole movie, dude.
The theme of the movie, and I honestly think that Zack Snyder had this as his theme of the movie.
Yeah.
Was hope.
Yeah.
Don't give up hope, even when it's darkest, because the movie, and I loved that little scene at the beginning of the movie when the kids are interviewing Superman for the blog.
Yeah, that was cool, man.
Fantastic scene. Mm-hmm. I still want to know when they said,
Whedon scene.
Yeah, he's like, what's your favorite part? Or he's like, what's the best thing about planet Earth? And he thinks, and then it cuts before he answers.
Yeah.
In his mind, I'm thinking he's thinking Lois Lane, but I don't know. You know, excellent scene.
Yeah. Great scene.
But he points out that the S, which in the DCEU, Superman's S is the Kryptonian symbol for hope.
Yeah.
It winds like a river. Hope, winds like a river kind of thing. So great scene. But the theme of the movie really is don't give up hope. And Superman represents hope.
Right.
Right. So, and to Zack Snyder's credit, in his own dark way, he was going to tell that, right? I really think so.
I suppose so.
I think he would.
But as far as I'm concerned, I'll never know because I'm going to watch the Joss Whedon clips in there because, frankly, you brought up exactly one of the scenes that I had in mind that was like, that is clearly, well, first of all, clearly it's a Joss Whedon scene because
you're talking about that very opening.
Yeah, with the kids on the
Will you answer questions for our blog?
Yeah, man, that was freaking amazing. That was really, really good.
Out of all the people you've saved, how many have you saved? Because the kids are all nervous.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it was fantastic. And the fact that Superman went along with it was great, too. That's the side of Superman we never
saw. Superman was Superman in this movie.
Yes.
And did you notice, I'm almost 100% positive that they lightened his costume up a little bit.
Just
or at least
scotch.
Didn't put the filters on it.
Yeah. Dude, that was the whole movie. The color palette got cranked up a bit on the brightness scale.
Yeah, which is good.
Way good. And honestly, that's the other reason why you can almost tell the difference between the Snyder scenes and the Whedon scenes was because of the color correction on it. It was just, Snyder, stay away, dude.
Yeah, well, here's the perfect, and this will sum up Snyder handling the DC movies, in my opinion. Go to YouTube. Somebody took scenes from Man of Steel.
Yeah.
And they put them side by side, and they put Zack Snyder's color version, and then they did their own color correction.
How much better did it look?
Much better. Hmm. Much better.
Probably would have been better.
Yeah, they intentionally darkened and filtered Man of Steel and all that.
Yeah.
For some reason, Zack Snyder thinks that's what he wants to do. So, anyway.
Done with that guy.
Yeah. Well, in DC.
Yeah.
For the DC movies,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So
he can do whatever he wants as long as he stays away from DC. It's kind of like the guy that got fired from Marvel.
Yeah. Do whatever you want. Just don't mess with my Marvel comics.
Don't come near my DCEU again.
All right. I'm down with that. So, Zach, did you like the movie?
Oh, I really enjoyed it.
Okay.
I did. It was 2 hours of fun. You know, when I went yesterday, you know, after I left the film, I mean, it was just, I had a great time. It's what I go to the movies to do.
Right.
You know, just having a great time at the movies and enjoy a film. And that's what I felt about.
And that's what we need to get back to.
Exactly.
Is at the end of the day, these movies are entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
Entertain us. Let's have some fun.
I had fun.
Show respect to the fans of the source material.
I believe that was.
And have fun.
Done.
You know, and Marvel's just been.
They mentioned Aquaman's mom, for goodness sake.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Come on.
Right.
Yeah. That was a nugget of fan.
Yeah, they were dropping.
Yeah
there was, that was a deep cut.
And I know there was probably way more Atlanta stuff that was on that
was.
Cutting room
it's
floor.
Cut. Yep. There's a scene with Volko.
Yeah.
Willem Dafoe plays Volko.
Yeah.
There was more conversation with Mira, which this is weird. I even caught this the first time I saw it. I'm like, why is Mira making a bubble of air so they could talk? Because they're in Atlantis underwater.
Yeah.
But I guess that was for the viewers somehow made it easier for them.
Yeah.
But they did say in the Aquaman movie, they're not playing that. They'll talk somehow underwater without a quote unquote bubble of air.
Okay.
Bubble of air. Yeah. So
I wondered about that.
That was really weird. So,
Mira now not even said her name. Her name wasn't even mentioned in the movie.
I think there in other scenes it was. There
yeah.
was more of her.
Yeah.
I don't know. So here's the thing on whether we get a Zack Snyder cut or whether we get an extended Joss Whedon cut or whatever happens, I will say this. The theatrical version of Batman v Superman mm-hmm. was uneven and choppy and not a very good movie.
Oh, awful.
The Ultimate Edition on DVD,
so much
they put
better.
Like 40-something... Much better.
Tons better.
Tons better. So if you haven't seen Batman v Superman in the Ultimate Edition, go do that.
It's worth your time.
Yeah, and I'm hoping we get that for JL because it'll take an already good movie and hopefully make it even better.
If you leave the Joss Whedon scenes in, I don't disagree
can
with
they,
that.
Can they, though, right? Can they? Can.
But see, that's my point, is I don't want to see a Zack Snyder cut if it doesn't have the scenes in it that I like.
Right.
You know? I mean, if you can make it work where you keep the Joss Whedon stuff, then great. Do that. But if what we have now is what we're going to have,
unless,
you know, and then which two are you going to consider canon?
Right.
Are you going to consider the Snyder cut canon? Or are you going to...
But what secretly is geeks, we love that.
I know.
We love the arguments as geeks. Okay.
I know.
I got to... So my quick take, the first time I saw it, I liked it. I felt it was a little uneven. One thing I think that kind of stunned me back and kind of got me out of the willing suspension of disbelief and started mm-hmm. thinking, the way they decided to bring back Superman seemed to just come completely out of left field. And I was not expecting it at all, and it just—I
wasn't either. That's one of the reasons why I kind of enjoyed it in a way.
Well, see, I did. It just kind of threw me. I thought he would show up in the black suit, and you know,
I did too.
Right? So,
yeah.
But you know, when they decided to use the mother box and the Kryptonian chamber that made Doomsday and all that, but what really, I mean, just all of a sudden, it's like, oh, we have a mother box. Let's resurrect Superman, and I was like, that just seems so out of left field. So that was, but the second.
They needed the power source. They explained
they did.
It.
And the scene that followed it was fantastic.
I'm talking about the.
Oh, right.
Oh, yeah. The fight. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, there's spoilers.
That was a little Marvel-y.
One of my favorite scenes. I have two favorite scenes in the whole movie other than the post credits with Superman and Flash. One is when Heavy Metal Aquaman smashes the whiskey bottle.
Yeah.
And jumps into the crashing waves.
Yeah.
While Icky Thump by the White Stripes is playing.
Awesome.
Love that scene.
Good scene.
My other most favorite scene is when Superman's fighting like everybody at the monument because he's all confused and evidently itchy because bringing back from the dead is mm-hmm. makes you itchy, according to him.
Yeah.
I think that was a Buffy callback, supposedly. That's what they said. It was a Buffy callback. When the Flash is running super fast.
Oh, my goodness.
And then Superman, like everybody else is in slow motion. And Superman's holding everybody, and he just kind of casually looks over at Flash while Flash is in super speed. Oh,
so good.
I flipped out.
So good, love dude. That.
And then he's
his eye. Yeah, just his eye kind of following looks, him.
Dude, they made Superman super. They didn't even play around.
Yes. See, and I credit that almost 100% to Josh Whedon.
Well, he evidently a lot of that was refilmed.
Yeah,
man. Because there were supposed to be tanks and all this stuff. Yeah,
dude.
Anyway, okay. So, but yeah, enjoy that. I will
credit
say,
where credit's due is all I'm trying to say.
Oh, man, I'm getting goosebumps. I love that scene. And then Flash is like, holy smokes. And he's trying to duck out of the way and everything.
Yeah.
Oh, and I did like how they did Flash's super speed. I thought it was cool.
Yeah,
I was good at that.
Yeah, so the second time I saw the movie, I guess because I already knew it felt much smoother to me.
Right.
But I still would like to see an extended cut.
I wouldn't mind seeing it, but as far as I'm concerned, the Justice League we have now
is good.
Is great.
It's good. I like it. So I will say, if you compare it to Thor Ragnarok, that Thor Ragnarok is a superior movie for everybody.
I don't disagree with that.
Right, like. My wife was just loving Thor Ragnarok and you know, she watched Justice League with me because she loves me. Right. Mm-hmm. So
of course,
so Marvel still has that edge in making movies that please everybody.
Yeah.
But DC's getting better at pleasing its fan base and pleasing more of the general audience.
Right.
So
I would say the schism between Thor Fraggle Rock and Justice League is, and I call it Fraggle Rock out of love.
Yeah, a lot of people.
I actually really, really liked the movie. But the thing that if you are comparing the two, one of the things that I think Thor, weirdly, and this really doesn't speak well of Justice League on this side of the Justice League film, is that Thor had the better villain.
He did. Well, and that. Man, I gotta address this real quick because I still want to give us some time after the break to talk about what we think the state of the DCU is.
Yeah.
I wrote that note down. I said, you know, why did you use Steppenwolf?
Of all the ones.
Especially because the second post-credit scenes makes it sound like a Legion of Doom is coming.
Yeah.
Just go to Darkseid.
Yeah.
Just pull out all the stops. You guys have got to hit a homer. To save this or to really bring
that
this
every that yeah. Darkseid was mentioned.
Yeah, he's mentioned. Use Darkseid. No one cares about Steppenwolf. I'm a comic book geek. I didn't care that Steppenwolf was in it. Right? I don't care.
He was serviceable. Yeah. You know?
No, he was serviceable, but this is the Justice League.
Yeah. I mean, for one thing, first of all, I mean the boom tubes.
Yeah.
Perfect.
I love the boom. I hate to, I gotta get us to a break.
I know.
Yeah, boom tubes were great.
Yeah. But
Steppenwolf, why?
Being a fan of the fourth world. Of Jack Kirby's fourth world. Right. Speaking of Jack Kirby, we had a lot of villains to choose from Darkseid's minions, and the fact that Darkseid is Steppenwolf's uncle instead of the other way around is weird. But Steppenwolf was very much an also ran in the comics.
Why?
Anyway.
Right? They're gonna say why Steppenwolf? Darkseid, just go to Darkseid.
I don't know.
Darkseid, Darkseid is the Omega. Oh, okay. Anyway. I got to get us to a break.
Okay.
But I did want to say, on behalf of all Heat members everywhere, Hal's Emerald Advancement Team, I loved they worked in a Green Lantern during the Tolkien fight scene.
Yeah, man.
Did that not remind you of Tolkien?
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay.
That was all Snyder.
Yeah, got to get us to a break. When we come back, we're going to try to spend a couple of minutes on, are we going to move forward with the DCU? What do we think's happening?
Okay.
But first, I got to give some love to Game Goblins. I'm pretty sure, folks... that I know it was yesterday. I think it's still going on today. Game Goblins has a Black Friday sale of if you buy one, you get the next thing half off. So check them out. Some Goblins are your friends. Game Goblins is Central Arkansas's premier retailer of Magic the Gathering, Warhammer 40K, board games, card games, RPGs, miniatures, and hobby accessories. Call Game Goblins at 501-224-GAME or visit them online at gamegoblins.com. Conveniently located 1121 South Bowman, right on the corner of Bowman and Canis in West Little Rock, and staffed by friendly employees, Game Goblins has everything you need for all your gaming stuff. They've also got an adult game night tonight, so go check them out. And first-time customers, mention Shane Plays and receive $10 off your purchase of $50 or more. Tell them Shane Plays sent you. Icky Thump! Heavy Metal Aquaman!
Need a bed in Espanol. So I give a drink of water, I'm gonna sing a
I love that scene with Aquaman. I really liked Heavy Metal Aquaman.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. You know, Warner Brothers reached out to me and they were considering me for the part of either Superman or Aquaman.
Okay.
But they said I was so amazingly buff, I would overwhelm all the other actors and the scenery. Yeah. So they said it's a case of being overqualified.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I didn't even swell up all the way. I just kind of barely swelled up on them.
Right on.
Yeah. So anyway,
thank you for not doing that now.
Well, it was their choice. I was all up for it. I was like, I'm going to get one of the two. Come on. But no, they went with Momoa, who I guess works out a little bit.
He does.
And Cavill is a hairy chested spectacle of beefy burrito of manhood.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, Zach, how much time we got left, buddy?
We've got about 8 minutes.
Okay.
That's enough.
Yeah. Let's see what we can do. I got to throw out a couple of notes there. One, you're a massive Green Lantern fan. We did get a Green Lantern in the movie.
We did, it was not, man. The Green Lantern. Visual confirmation.
Yeah,
of the
Green
Lantern.
I was like, oh, so that's how they'll do power constructs in this movie, the DCEU.
Yeah.
And, yeah. So, yeah, that Green Lantern straight got jacked up. So,
yeah
they have people in the movie. I got to say, it's straight up Tolkien Sauron scene.
Yeah.
From the beginning of Fellowship of the Ring. Like all the tribes of man, the Amazons,
the Atlanteans.
Aliens, Atlanteans, Green Lanterns, and the gods themselves fight Steppenwolf, and it's straight up Tolkien. Even when the tribe of man is burying, they look just like Tolkien.
Yeah, man.
But anyway, we got to see Green Lantern. One thing I'll say on my thoughts on the movie, I didn't get that one iconic Goosebumps Justice League moment.
Nah.
The closest thing was the very end when Flash and Cyborg are finally fist bumping.
Yeah.
That was kind of a iconic moment.
Yeah.
Batman, who had the best scenes in Batman v Superman, and Superman had the worst. It was flip-flop this time. Superman had the best.
Yeah.
And Batman did not really get a lot of good scenes, in my opinion. I love the end when Superman's like, I take it back, I wish I was dead. And Cyborg's like, my toes hurt. How is that even possible?
Because he doesn't have them.
Yeah, because he doesn't have toes. Like it. So
good.
But anyway, and then one thing I want to make sure to mention as we move into talking about the money that it's making and et cetera. Why does nobody ever factor in merchandising? Because but toys...
Shirts.
Blankets, sure. You know, merchandising is bringing in some money. So why, Michael, you got your ear closer to the ground on this stuff than I do.
Yeah.
Why does nobody factor in merchandising when they talk about, because, and I'll post these links on the show notes version of the show on the podcast and Krypton Radio. There's all these, it's underperforming. Now, overseas is doing pretty well.
Yeah.
Domestically, it's still making good money, but it's underperforming. It's it's the least performing movie of all the DCEU movies, period, including Suicide Squad so far.
Yeah.
So why is merchandising not mixed in?
Well, box office is easier to track.
Mm-hmm.
That's number one.
Let me ask you this. Is box office the only factor when they decide to make a sequel?
I would say no.
Okay.
But I'd say that it was probably 3/5 of a factor.
Okay.
Because that's how you're, I mean, if you're going to be dropping $250 million on a movie or more, you're going to want a return on that investment. You know what I mean? So what you're going to get back on that initially is your initial weekend box office until the next big movie comes out to take that money away from it.
Mm-hmm. Which it took a couple of weeks to bump it.
Yeah.
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 It
took 1 week.
Oh, did it take 1 week? I thought it did.
Coco bumped it.
Coco. Well, that's Pixar.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And I don't fault Coco for bumping Justice League, and I don't fault Justice League for Coco bumping it.
Right.
Like I said earlier, it's amazing money is being made on any of these movies,
right,
quite frank, because even if it comes in number two, which it did, it will by the time this weekend is over with for all you listeners in the future.
Yes.
But I don't think that's necessarily a failure at all. Just because it's underperforming what they thought, and
right,
by they, I don't know who they are, but what maybe it's Warner Brothers.
Batman v Superman made almost $1 billion, and they're like, not good enough.
Yeah.
Not good enough.
Right. So, well, first of all, this is a moneymaker. It will forever be a moneymaker.
All right. Are
if
we
going to do it
get...
cheaper, then they'll do it cheaper.
Well, this one costs a lot because of all the remakes and the.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of problems.
What are we going to get more DCEU? I mean, because they've pulled plugs on franchises and rebooted. Look at Spider-Man.
Oh, sure.
For much less.
Oh, yeah.
So are we going to, is there any chance that they're not going to keep moving forward with the DCEU?
I think it's zero chance that they won't. Okay. I think that they absolutely will.
I'm talking about a shared universe, not individual movies.
Oh, what do you mean? Like between movies?
Will we get another Justice League movie?
Oh, yeah.
With these characters, these actors, I mean?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I genuinely think we will. I genuinely think, well, we're definitely getting a Wonder Woman 2.
Right.
We're definitely going to get a Joss Whedon directed Batgirl movie, from what I understand. There is already not one, but two different Joker movies in the works.
You got a Deathstroke movie.
We're going to have a Deathstroke movie because we saw him at the very
end. Yeah, I loved the second post-screen post-credit scene where Luther's like, we should have a league of our own on that incredibly ridiculous yacht.
Yeah.
So
no, dude, they're not done. This is going to continue.
Now, here's the other question.
Yeah.
Based on what they've done up to this point, does the DCEU, as we know it so far, really deserve to keep moving forward, or should it have a reboot? Even if it was with the same actors.
Well, if you're going to reboot it, they've already put that contingency plan in place because the Flash movie is going to be Flashpoint.
Oh, Flashpoint. You can do whatever you want to continuity.
That's right. Yeah. After Flashpoint, even after it's resolved.
Folks, if you ever want to change everything, just go back in time and save your mother.
Yeah. And then go back in time and not save her. Right. And hopefully everything will snap back in place.
And cover yourself in chemicals and try to get struck by lightning and get your superpowers back.
Yeah.
And get fricasseed like a chicken.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so... Zach, do you want the DC Extended Universe as we know it to keep going?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I think I do.
Yeah,
but
man.
If we get a couple more movies that are tepid, I would start calling for a reboot.
And I think they call it the Extended Universe instead of just the DC Cinematic Universe or whatever. Because, and this is just
we got 2 minutes.
This is my wild theory.
Yeah.
All the TV series Gotham and the TV series Arrow and Flash and Legends of Tomorrow and whatever else, all of that are on multiple Earths that still connect with the cinematic universe as a multiple Earth situation. That's my theory, and that's...
And you're sticking to it.
I'm going to stick to it.
All right. We got about a minute left, Zach. Okay. Did you bring the bad joke of the week?
No.
Okay. I sent you a message in the middle of 10 other messages.
Yeah,
okay,
here we
go. What do you call it when Cyborg clobbers the bad guys?
Oh, no. What?
Tech knuckle support.
Woohoo!
All right. We have a special bonus one.
Oh, gosh.
All right. You're a comedian, so you'll play me on this one.
Okay.
Superman is so strong.
How strong is he?
He doesn't have triceps. He has succeedceps. Ha ha!
I understand.
Zach, take us... Folks, thanks for listening. Zach, take us out on Icky Thump by the White Stripes.
Now I hear Icky Thump, ooh, the thunk, sitting drunk on a wagon to Mexico. Well, what a chump, man, my head got a bum when I hit it on the radio. Redhead, senorita, look at that, can't be said, need a bed in Espanol.
So what now, my friend?
Well, the guys and I have been talking, and we're thinking about forming our own group.
Yeah, the Multiculture Pals.
Apache Chief. Black Vulcan.
That's Super Hulk.
Juan Gigante. The Negotiator and his super sidekick, Petzler. The French Tickler. And Jesse Jackson.
Multiculture Pals. Many heroes.
One voice.
Shane Plays Radio is blessed to have sponsors, and we appreciate them very much. However, did you know that you can also support the show as an individual for as little as $1 an episode? Simply go to patreon.com/ShanePlays.